Hi, it's Dennis Daly. The golden age of radio was one of the shortest golden ages of all time, yet during its run, radio brought about immense change in America. Radio brought us through the Depression and the Second World War, and then struggled on until television finally won the battle for supremacy in American media. Radio had begun just after the turn of the last century as dots and dashes, listened to by do-it-yourself radio enthusiasts. Then early voice transmissions brought radio into its first age. By the 30s, the techniques were perfected, the networks were in place, and radio was on its way. The war changed everything, as did the coming of television. On the night of September 30th, 1962, when yours truly, Johnny Dollar, and Suspense signed off on the CBS radio network, the golden age ended. But radio's final 25 years were golden indeed. So join me now as we explore radio's last 25 years. 1961 was the next to the last year of old-time radio. It saw the inauguration of John Kennedy. Alan Shepard became the first man in space. Gus Grissom followed 2 months later. East Germany started building the Berlin Wall. By the end of 61, there would be about 2,000 American advisors in Vietnam. The U.S. severed diplomatic relations with Cuba as Fidel Castro became more belligerent and more tied to Moscow. And listeners to radio couldn't find many of their old favorites. They were all gone, including Fibber McGee and Molly, which was moved over to weekend radio as a series of 5-minute vignettes on the weekend program Monitor. But by this year, by 1961, people were beginning to collect old-time radio, and Fibber McGee and Molly were showing up in a lot of people's collections. Let's go back now, a decade or so, when the golden age of radio, well, when that age was still golden. And remember, Fibber McGee and Molly.
The makers of Johnson's Wax and Johnson's Self-Polishing Glow Coat present Fibber McGee and Molly, written by Don Quinn, with songs by Martha Tilton and the Johnson Wax Program with Fibber McGee and Molly. Makers of Johnson's Wax and Johnson's Self-Polishing Glow Coat present Fibber McGee and Molly, written by Don Quinn, with songs by Martha Tilton and the King's Men, and music by Billy Mills. The show opens with There's a Great Day Coming Manana. To have a lot of fun with electric trains. Even now, whenever I see one spread out on a playroom floor, I can hardly resist the temptation to join the party. I guess that's one of the reasons why I always get a thrill when I see a modern, glittering streamliner whiz by. How would you like the job of washing one of those streamlined beauties, keeping it clean and sparkling? Some job, I should think. And yet, even there, wax can lend a hand, protect those shining surfaces against wear, and make cleaning a much easier job. Yes, sir, at the Johnson's Wax Laboratories, they have actually developed a special wax dressing which can be sprayed or brushed on the outside of these trains. A wax polish, if you please, that makes the job of washing a streamliner relatively easy. It's already being used successfully on the Milwaukee Road's famous Hiawatha. An interesting example of how far the makers of Johnson's Wax have gone in making their wax polishes useful to industry as well as to your home and mine. For your own protection, the next time you're shopping, be sure to get the genuine Johnson's Wax polish. You had gone to Hollywood and been co-starred in a moving picture. And then the picture was going to have its world premiere next week in your neighborhood theater in your hometown. Just imagine how you'd feel if the picture was Look Who's Laughing. The theater was the Bijou, the town was Wistful Vista, and you were Fibber McGee and Molly.
Oh, isn't it thrilling, McGee?
Yeah.
Imagine us in the movies and having the premiere right here in Wistful Vista.
Well, this town's been good to us, and they deserve it. I'll always remember Wistful Vista. Even when I get to be a big screen lover like Henry Fonda and Gary Cooper and Billy Burke.
Now, Billy Burke is a woman.
He is? I mean, is she? Oh. Well, you know what I mean. I mean, when I get started playing romantic scenes with some of them glamour gals like Jean Herschel and...
No. Jean Herschel is a man.
Is she? Uh-huh. Oh.
Maybe you better do westerns. Nobody will care whether your horse is a boy or a girl.
I'm more the romantic type. I'm the kind
of... Oh, now, take it easy, McGee. Huh? Take it easy. Remember, there's only one man who will ever command respect by blowing his own horn.
Who?
Gabriel. Incidentally, did you call the Bijou Theater and reserve a block of seats?
Oh, say, I better do that. Give me the phone.
Here.
Thanks. Hello, operator. Give me the Bijou Theater. Hey, is that you, Mert?
Oh, dear. More dirt from Mert.
How's every little thing, Mert? Is, eh? What's that, Mert? Your sister. Broke her nose, eh?
Oh.
Oh, that's wonderful, Mert.
Oh, heavenly days, McGee. What's wonderful about that?
Her sister made a lot of dough on the stock market, but just how much? Only her broke her nose. What's that, Mert? Oh, okay, I'll call him later. Goodbye, Myrtle. The line's busy, Molly.
Well, we better get busy, too.
Huh?
If we're going to invite Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy to stay with us next week, we've got to straighten up this house. And anyway... Who's that?
I'll peek out and see. Uh-oh. It's Mrs. Uppington. And you ought to see her. She's got on one of them off-the-face hats.
Well, on her, it should look good. She's got one of those off-the-hat faces. Come in. How do you do, Mrs. Uppington? So nice to see you.
Oh, how do you do, my dear? And Miss McGee?
Hi, Uppy. Well, you look in the pink of condition. Though I didn't know conditions were that bad.
Miss McGee, you mischievous boy.
Yeah, I'm a
rip. Yes. I'm afraid you're always pulling my arm. As the saying goes.
It's a leg, as the saying really goes, Abigail.
I know, my dear, but I have always maintained that humor was not necessarily dependent on vulgarity.
No, but it sometimes helps. Hey, what you got there, Uppy? Been doing some Christmas shopping?
Christmas shopping? Oh, my, I almost forgot. Here, this is for you.
For us? Oh, Abigail, you shouldn't have done it.
Yeah, how do you know she shouldn't have, Molly? What is it, Uppy?
You may unwrap it if you wish, Mr. McGee.
Oh, okay. Oh. Oh,
well, well, heavenly day.
Oh, a drinking fountain.
A new smoking stand.
Oh.
And green lights. Beautiful, Abigail, but
why? Well, my dear, with all those important people coming for the premiere next week, I thought that... Oh, well, I did want your house to look nice. And the one bad note in this room, to me, has always been that ash receiver of Mr. McGee's. So I took the liberty...
Oh, how thoughtful of you, Mrs. Uppington. I am simply delighted.
Yeah.
And that old smoking stand of McGee's was beginning to smell horribly of cigars.
Well, it's getting hard to find cigars made of gardenias. Defense program, you know. Ah, but thanks, Abby. Gee, it's really beautiful.
Well, the only thing is, it makes your Davenport look very shabby and tired.
Oh, say. It does at that, McGee.
Huh?
Look at that velour. The nap looks like it just heard the alarm clock.
Well, you could get a new Davenport, you know.
Oh, we might at that, McGee. What do you say?
Well, I don't know,
say,
Molly.
Come
I...
to think of it, there's a clearance sale at the Bonton, isn't there, Abigail?
Oh, indeed there is, my dear. What? In fact, I just bought this hat there. Isn't it simply ducky?
It's ducky, all right. It's as foul a hat as I ever...
It's quite all right, Mrs. McGee. After all, one never expects a man to understand a woman's taste in hats.
Say, isn't it the truth, Abigail? And why should he talk? Did you ever see him in that little green Tyrolean hat of his with the yellow feather in the band?
Oh, indeed, I have, my dear. He looks quite dashing.
Oh, dashing, eh?
Yes. Dashing home from a dogfight. Touché, Mr. McGee. Touché.
What do you mean, touché? I never wore a touché in my life. I I've got as much hair now as I ever had.
No, dearie. Not toupee. Touche. Mm. That's a French expression, meaning I got you that time, didn't I?
And you are quite right, my dear. Men should never criticize women's clothes.
I should say not.
Toupee, girl. Toupee.
King's Men sing Louisiana Hayride.
I'd like to be again a kid on the farm again, work until the sun goes down. Get out the wagon, pile in the hay, gather all the folks for miles around, then get going, Louisiana Hayride. Get going, we all is ready. Get going, Louisiana Hayride. Get up and start to roll. Get going, Louisiana Hayride. Get going, we all is ready. Get going, Louisiana Hayride. Get up and start to roll. Oh, I like that sport, riding in the hay. I love it away, oh, oh. Oh, the time is short. Crack your little whip and get your little ship to go. Get all aboard, take a little ride. Moon is shining bright. Hide in the hay, sing and play. We'll take a ride tonight. Giddy up, Nellie.
Henry, call the roll.
Yes, sir. Maybell, Emily.
We're here.
Sally, Isabel.
We're here.
Mortimer, Ferdinand.
We're here.
Jeremiah, Franklin.
We're here.
Clementina, Carolina, Evelina, Dinah.
We're all here in the evening by the moonlight. You can hear the darkies singing as we ride in.
The night is bright, bright as day. By and by our heads will nod. Silently back home we'll plod. Whoa, Nelly, whoa. How it up to be again, a boy to go and see again. The yellow moon to blow again, the pink gal to go again. Hey, right in my hand.
McGee, shall we go downtown and buy a new Davenport or shan't we?
Oh, I suppose we better. Oh, we'll never get as good a one as this one has been.
Yeah, you'll never save that many cigar coupons again either.
You said it, baby. I practically inhaled all the furniture in this room.
Well, I wish you'd have taken a few extra puffs and got a better looking floor lamp.
What's the matter with the floor lamp?
Well, the cord's all frayed for one thing. Oh. I told you a dozen times to run the wire under the rug.
Doggone it, I tried to, and darn near smothered under there.
Well, never mind that now. Get your hat and let's get going. With this clearance sale, we ought to get a nice Davenport.
Oh, come in.
Hi, mister.
Oh, hi, little girl. I'm sorry I haven't got time to talk to you now. I got to go downtown.
Why?
Got to buy a new Davenport.
Why?
Well, because we're expecting some important guests next week.
Why?
Because they're holding the world premiere of our picture at the Bijou Theater next week, that's why. And stop asking why.
Hmm?
I said stop. Oh. Sis, you're impossible.
I am not, I betcha.
Oh, yes, you are.
Oh, no, I'm not.
Oh, yes.
Oh, no, I can't be impossible, I betcha.
Why?
Because impossible means it couldn't happen, and I happened.
Why?
And stop saying why.
Okay, okay. All I can say, sis, is you've certainly got a gift for butting in here whenever we're ready to go someplace.
Gee, have I, mister? What is it?
What's what?
My gift.
I didn't say you had a gift.
You did, too. I heard you just as plain.
Well, I didn't mean it that way. I meant it.
Engine giver, engine giver, engine giver.
That is just keep quiet. I'll give you a gift. I'll do anything. But quit yelling at me. Now, what do you want?
Tell me a story.
Gee. Sis, you mean to stand there with your first teeth making a last stand? And ask for a story when you know darn well we're in a hurry to get downtown?
Gee, mister, I guess you don't love little children.
Yes, I do, too, love little children. Don't you love big men?
Gee, sure I do, mister. You want me to tell you a story, do you,
Well, I'd much prefer that. Go ahead.
Okay. Once upon a time, there was a little Boston Bull Terrier, and some bad boys tried to tie a tin can on him, but they couldn't do it.
Well, go on with the story.
That's all. It was a very short tale.
Very likely tale. If that little twerp ever...
McGee, never mind that. We got to get down to the furniture store. It's getting late.
Oh, it is. Okay, well, come on, let's go.
Mrs. McGee, I assure you that this is definitely the Davenport for you.
All right, Mr. Twombly. Send it right out.
Very well. Now that you have this lovely new Davenport, don't you think the rest of your furniture might look just a teeny-weeny bit lousy?
Now, wait a minute, Twom. You can't stand
there... He's right, McGee. Absolutely right. With all our old stuff, that new Davenport will be as conspicuous as a cow in a canoe.
Indeed it will, madam. Whereas it should be as casual as a hug on a hayride.
Oh. Well, what are we going to do about it? Move everything out but the Davenport and just let the guests in three at a time?
No, but we've got to have new draperies and a couple of end tables, and that bookcase is pretty battered. And the floor lamp isn't much good.
What kind of a floor lamp is it?
Oh, it's one of them three-way lights, bud. It goes out if you bump it, touch it, or look at it. Well, maybe you're right, Molly.
Why, of course I'm right, McGee. Next week is one of the most important occasions in our lives. And with some new furniture, why, we...
Hello, Molly. Hello, Feber.
Hello, Harlow.
Oh, what's the matter with you, Mr. Wilcox?
You look like someone that stripped the gears on your kitty car, Si.
Oh, it's nothing. Forget it. I just met Billy Mills down the piano department, and he offered me tickets to a football game, and I lost my temper, that's all.
Oh. Heavenly days, why?
Well, I just dislike football, that's all. I despise it. I hate football. I don't understand, Mr. Wilcox. Why should you have such an aversion to the thrilling spectacle of 11 muscular gentlemen kicking the teeth out of 11 other muscular gentlemen? Well, I'll tell you what my aversion is. How could I, a guy making his living selling genuine Johnson self-polishing glow coat, the finest no-rubbing, no-buffing floor polish, how could I ever enjoy a game that depends on substitutes? Sending in substitutes. It burns me up.
Oh, but Mr. Wilcox, you could watch the practice games. Maybe a good scrub team would...
Listen to her. Scrub team. Don't say scrub to me. With Johnson's self-polishing glow coat making your kitchen linoleum so easy to keep clean and beautiful without old-fashioned scrub... Oh, I can't stand it. Let me out of here. Scrub team. Substitutes. Football.
Temperamental fellow, isn't he?
No, he takes his work very seriously, Mr. Twombly.
Yeah, he's almost too conscientious. That guy won't even send the home office a night letter unless it's a nice night. Well, what am I waiting for? Or what are we waiting for?
Where are the draperies, Mr. Twombly?
Oh, yes, the draperies. Right down the stairs over here, Mrs. McGee.
Well, I think these draperies will do us very nicely, Mr. Twombly.
Yes, I think you've done us very nicely, too, Twombly.
Thank you. And now for some of the smaller pieces, Mrs. McGee.
What do you mean, smaller pieces? Ain't we bought enough stuff?
Now, McGee, be reasonable.
Huh?
With a new Davenport and new draperies, we can't have that other tacky-looking furniture spoiling the effect.
You mean just because we get a new ashtray, we got to refurnish the whole house to go with it? Why don't I just give up smoking?
For good?
Well, why not?
You can't do it.
I can, too. I've done it a dozen times. Why, I remember the...
Oh, excuse me a moment. Some gentleman is trying to catch my attention. Was there something I could do for you, sir?
No, my dapper dispenser of domestic doodads. There's nothing you can do for me, but I'm about to do something for you. One of those charitable impulses to which I rarely become a victim.
Hey, Molly, it's Horatio K. Boomer. Hiya, Boomer.
Hello, Mr. Boomer. We haven't seen you for a long time.
Ah, there. Good day, my dear. A nasty November to you, soybean.
Where you been keeping yourself, Boomer?
Haven't been keeping myself, Egg Roll. I've been kept. Been detained for a few months upstate on a charge of loitering.
Oh, loitering. Why, they can't sentence you for several months just for loitering.
They can if you're loitering in the First National Bank after closing hours, my dear.
Well, what were you doing in there after hours?
Just trying to straighten out a check, Stubb.
But what was it you wished to see me about, sir?
Oh, yes. Thought you might like to know I saw a shoplifter upstairs.
Oh.
On the fourth floor of the West Wing. Suggest you investigate.
Heavenly days, a shoplifter. Are you sure, Mr. Boomer?
Certainly, certainly. I should know a shoplifter when I see one.
I'll say you should, Boomer. You've seen so much of the seamy side of life, you got lint in your outlook.
Well,
Thank you very much, Mr. Boomer. I'll report the matter very shortly. We don't like shoplifters in here.
Glad to be of service, my boy. Remember, fourth floor, west wing. Saw the fellow several times with my own eyes. Well, good day, my dear. The superficial so long to you, Simp.
So long, Boomer.
Imagine Mr. Boomer meeting a shoplifter face to face.
Incidentally, what do they sell in the west wing of the fourth floor, Bud?
Looking glasses and mirrors.
Oh.
Now, let's see. What other furnishings did you have in mind, Mrs. McGee? Perhaps...
Martha Tilton sings Blue Champagne.
Shadows and blue champagne, with the echoes that still remain, I keep a blue rendezvous. Bubbles rise like a mountain before my eyes, and they suddenly crystallize to form a vision of you. All the plans we started, all the songs we sang, each little dream we knew seems to overtake me like a boomerang. Blue is the sparkle, dawn is the tang. Each old refrain keeps returning as I remain with my memories and blue champagne. Toast the dream that was you. All the plans we started, all the songs we sang, each little dream we knew seems to overtake me like a boomerang. Blue is the sparkle, gone is the tang. Each old refrain returning as I remain with my memories and blue champagne to toast the dream that brought you.
Boys, but please move that bookcase farther to the right there.
Now, careful, fellas. Don't scratch my new ashtray.
That's it. Thank you very much.
Okay, lady.
Well, how does it look, McGee?
I got it.
Everything in its place already.
Yeah, looks pretty good, Molly. Especially the ashtray. You know, if it hadn't been for Mrs. Uppington, we'd have never refurnished this room. Bless her heart. I wish she had to pay the bill, darn her hide.
Don't talk like that, dearie. This room is really livable now.
The only thing I don't like is this new rug, Molly.
It's a beautiful rug. A genuine Oriental.
The tag says it was made by the Weave a Million Rug Company in Hackensack, New Jersey.
Absolutely. I always say if you buy an Oriental rug, get one made by honest American labor. Come in.
Hello there, Mrs. McGee. Hello, Mr. McGee.
Oh, hi, Wimple, old man. Come in and curl your corpus up on our new Davenport.
Well, how are you today, Mr. Wimple?
Oh, just fine, Mrs. McGee. I saw the men moving your new furniture in, so I just sat right down on the curbstone and wrote you a poem.
Oh, how nice.
I'll reserve judgment till I hear your living room lyrics, Wimp.
I think it's one of my best pieces, Mr. McGee. I really do. The title is, The End Table Broke Its Leg and We Had to Shoot It Back to the Factory.
Read it in your well-modulated voice, Mr. Wimple.
All righty. It goes, Here's to the McGees in their well-furnished home. I hope they'll be happy, this princess and prince.
Prince don't rhyme, Wimple.
I know, Mr. McGee, but I don't like to call you a gnome. They have only one piece which the room could well lack. That new straight-back chair should be sent right straight back. Do you like it?
What, the chair or the phone?
I think it was very sweet of you, Mr. Wimple. Do you often sit down on curbstones and write poetry?
Oh, we poets must work wherever the mood strikes us, Mr. McGee. Some of my best work I do while I'm, well, almost anywhere in the house. Except in my wife's gymnasium. I can't work there.
See, your wife is very athletic, isn't she, Mr. Wimple?
Indeed, she is, Mrs. McGee. She can put the shot 99 yards, you know.
Honest? You go in for any of that stuff, Wimple?
Only the 100-yard dash, Mrs. Wimple.
Well, hasn't Mrs. Wimple any feminine qualities, Mr. Wimple?
Oh, yes, Mrs. McGee, of course. She's really a very feminine person. You should see men leap up to give her their seats on the streetcar.
Do they really?
Indeed, they do. Or else. Well, I just dropped in to say hello, folks. So, goodbye.
Poor little Wimple. He sure has it tough, don't he?
I'll bet the worm will turn someday, McGee.
Yep. Just in time to see the hen's last peck. Let's forget, Wimple. Let's just sit here and enjoy my new ashtray and stuff.
Oh, isn't this room beautiful now?
Yeah, my new ashtray sure sets it off, don't it? Ah, good old Uppy.
Oh, and isn't this Davenport comfortable?
Yeah, I bet my hip will heal up now where that spring always dug into it.
I wouldn't be surprised. Just look how the pattern in those draperies harmonizes.
Oh, now who? Come in.
Oh, hello, Mrs. Uppington. Come in and see what you're responsible for.
What I'm responsible for? Oh, my dear. Oh, it's lovely. All new furniture and draperies. And a rug. Oh, how lovely.
You like it, Uppy?
It's simply charming, Miss McGee. If I had done it myself, I wouldn't change a thing. Not a single thing. Except possibly...
Except what?
That smoking stand. It's a little modernistic for the room, wouldn't you say?
The smoking stand?
But, Dad, right, if the whole room was refurnished around that smoking stand, and I love it.
And you gave it to us.
Oh, yes, I know, but since you have redecorated, it is entirely out of key.
Oh.
Now, here, I'll show you.
No.
Let's throw it out.
No. Wait a minute.
There now. Isn't that better? Now the room is utterly charming. Oh, I don't know what gave you the idea to do it over, but it was a splendid idea. Good night.
Take it easy, dear. Control yourself. Have a cigar.
I can't. There's no place to put the ashes.
Forget the ashes. Light up a cigar. And give me one, too.
The other day, I went shopping with my wife. As we wandered through the stores from one department to another, I was struck with one thing which seems to me to be quite important. Good taste is on the increase. Manufacturers of clothes, furniture, fabrics, floor coverings, all have been constantly improving the design of their merchandise. You don't have to have a lot of money now to have a beautiful, attractive home, and you don't need a lot of money to keep it beautiful either. You can do that so easily with genuine Johnson's Wax, the wax polish that protects as well as beautifies your floors, furniture, woodwork, that saves you money and saves you work, that has over 100 extra labor-saving uses. There are, of course, imitations of Johnson's Wax on the market. But if I were you, I'd play safe and insist on the genuine Johnson's Wax, liquid, cream, or paste.
Are Edgar Bergen and Charlie McCarthy really going to visit us next week?
Sure they are.
Positively?
Absolutely.
How can you be sure?
Because Charlie McCarthy promised me on bended knee.
Who's bended knee?
Bergen's.
Oh. Good night. Good night, all.
This is Harlow Wilcox, speaking for the makers of Johnson's Wax Finishes for home and industry, inviting you to be with us again next Tuesday night. Good night.
Now back into the archives for yet a second episode of Fibber McGee and Molly.
Johnson Wax Program with Fibber McGee and Molly. The makers of Johnson's Wax products for home and industry present Fibber McGee and Molly, written by Don Quinn and Phil Leslie, with music by the King's Men and Billy Mills Orchestra. time you walked down the shining hallway of a big modern office building or a hospital corridor? Did you stop to wonder how the floors in schools, hospitals, and public buildings are protected against the thousands of feet that tramp across them? How they're kept beautiful in spite of all that traffic? Well, if you were to look into the janitor's supply room in these buildings, you'd find Johnson's wax polishes in a great many of them. Yes, those famous Johnson's wax products are used in the maintenance of millions of square feet of such floors from coast to coast. Careful tests have proved the wax method to be best for beauty, best for economy, and labor saving. And in these fields, too, polishes that bear the Johnson label are given top ratings. If you have anything to do with the problem of maintaining the floors in schools, hospitals, churches, office, and public buildings, it will pay you to write to S.C. Johnson, Racine, Wisconsin, or Brantford, Canada, for full details. Winter is a wonderful time of the year, if you care for that sort of thing. Some people like to stay home by the fire. Others like to go out and skate for hours on end. They don't even care which end. And here at 79 Wistful Vista are two of our favorite winter sports, Fibber McGee and Molly.
Don't get so close to the fireplace, dear. You'll fall in.
Think I ought to put on another log on?
No, I don't. You've got it so hot in here now, the doorknobs are turning brown.
Yeah. Maybe it is a little warm at that. I'll open the window a second. Get a load of that ooze on.
Put that window down, please.
Oh, boy, that air is wonderful out there.
Well, leave it out there. Don't bring it in here.
This is the kind of a night for a long walk, you know it. I'd like to get into my mucklucks, wrap a muffler around my neck, and hike out to Dugan's Lake and back.
Yeah. Include me as the saying goes out. I'm very happy right here with my glass of root beer, my new murder mystery, and my pan full of popcorn, if you'll pardon the vulgar expression.
Yeah, but you...
Yeah, you hitch up the dog sled and carry the serum to Alaska. Mommy stays home. Go on, mush.
Yeah. Shucks, we may not have another night like this all winter. Clear, sharp, and beautiful. Makes your blood tingle.
I can get the same effect by sitting on my foot for 20 minutes.
Oh, gee whiz, I don't want to go alone. I just thought
you were just bluffing, dearie. I know you. You wouldn't stir away from this fireplace tonight if it was snowing $10 bills.
Oh, yeah? Well, I'll show you who's bluffing, Tootsie. By George, I'm going to get into my coat and walk clear out to Dugan's Lake and back. That's where I'm going to walk clear out to and back.
Your mittens are on the hall table.
Huh? Oh, okay. Well, here I go. I'm going now.
Hello, Mrs. McGee. Mr. McGee.
Oh, hi, Alice.
Hello, Alice.
Creepers, you both look comfortable and happy sitting by this wonderful fire.
Well, himself here thinks it's very exhilarating weather, Alice. He's even thinking of taking a long walk.
Out to Dugan's Lake and back, Alice.
Are you kidding, Mr. McGee? Why, it's colder than the keel of a kayak.
Bah, just a tang in the air, that's all. But what do you say we all go? We can throw snowballs on the way and build a snowman. Dive into snowdrifts. Have fun. Come on, let's go.
Have some popcorn, Alice?
Yes, thank you. What are you reading, Mrs. McGee?
Oh, it's a new crime club book, Alice. The Man Who Asked Why.
Oh.
Oh, it's wonderful. I've read page 39 four times. Thanks to my little lover of the great outdoors here.
Okay, sissies, okay. I'll go alone then. You two panty waist can stay here and make like a couple of hothouse petunias.
Oh, well, I couldn't go anyway, Mr. McGee. Bud's calling for me in half an hour. We're going to a movie.
Oh, who's Bud, dear?
Bud is the floor walker in my department at the Bon Ton who always wears a carnation in his buttonhole's cousin.
I see. Well... You'll have to sit if you don't get started pretty soon because all the theaters are pretty crowded these days in the balcony.
You and Bud will be perfectly welcome to stay here by the fire, Alice. There's plenty more popcorn and apples and marshmallows.
Oh, gee, thanks, Mrs. McGee. Maybe I will ask Bud to stay here this evening. We could sit by the fire and... Oh, look at Mr. McGee. You look like you were going to the North Pole, Mr. McGee.
Enjoy yourself, dearie.
Oh, I will, believe me. A few miles in this bracing air and
I'll get it.
When will I take this overcoat off?
You don't have to take your coat off to answer the phone.
Well, maybe somebody wants me to stay home for something, right? Hello? Who? Oh, yeah, she's right here. For you, Alice.
Oh, thanks, Miss McGee. Hello? Yes, this is Alice. What? No, that wasn't my father. That was the house that I rent a room in, Zoner. Yes. Well, look, Bud, how about if we stay right here tonight? The fireplace is... What? Fine. Goodbye, Bud. He says I talked him into it.
Well, get going, McGee. Here's your coat and mittens.
Huh? Oh, well, okay. Well, so long.
Goodbye.
Well, here I go. Anybody home?
Oh, my gosh, old Doc Gamble. Come on in, Doc. Take off your things. Here, Molly, take my coat. I can't go out now. Yeah, we got company. Ah, good old Doc. Come on right in, Doc. Sit as well, huh?
This has all been very nice, but I don't want to upset any of your plans. I see little Bucklewart here is all dressed up to go out.
Ah, forget it, Doc. Stick around. I'm just going out for a little stroll is all. Nothing important.
A little stroll? In this blizzard? Why, your ears would drop off before you got to the corner.
Hmm?
Not that that wouldn't be a facial improvement.
Yeah? He says he's going to walk out to Dugan's Lake and back, Doctor.
Creepers, that's quite a hike. I rode out there once on the back of a fellow I knew at the airplane plant named Ozzie Simpson's motorcycle. And was it ever rugged? Oh, you said it.
Oh, sure. You're all making a lot of fuss about a little walk in the crisp winter air. I like winter walking. I feel marvelous with the wind in my face, head up, chest out, swinging my arms with the frosty stars twinkling down.
Oh, stop it, you little double-malted extrovert. Well, you hate winter weather as much as I do. Any time I deliberately walk into a gale, it'll be Gale Patrick. Where are you going, Alice?
Oh, I've got to go up and fix my hair, Doctor. My boyfriend is coming over. Have a nice walk, Mr. McGee.
Thanks, kid. I will.
Take off your things, boys, and relax. I guess McGee's in for the night.
Why, of course he is. Ain't a fit night out for man nor beast. Not that McGee could be classified as either one.
I never heard such a lot of silly nonsense about a little walk in the fresh air.
Okay, go ahead, deep freeze. We'll give you a 10-minute start, and then we'll send out to St. Bernard's. What a switch that is. The dog's going to you.
I can take it. I got Indian blood in me. I'm 1/16th Potawatomi.
You know, I think he really is, Doctor.
Betcha.
At least he dances much better alone than he does with me.
Well, if he's 1/16th Indian, my mummy was an Egyptian. What does it prove, anyway? That's for me.
How do you know, Doctor?
Anytime the weather gets below zero and I'm chatting comfortably in a warm home with friends and the phone rings, it's for me. Somebody's child has just swallowed a toy soldier, and I've got to go and demobilize him.
Well, what'd you expect? Did you take up medicine so he could sit in your big fat office all...
I get it. 79 Whistle Vista, Molly McGee speaking. Who? Yes, he's right here. For you, Doctor.
It is? Thank you. Gamble speaking. Yes. Well, yes, I... The bishop. Great Scott. Don't move him till I get there. Yes, I'll hurry. Hand me my coat and hat, McGee, quick. See you later, folks.
Oh, my gosh, something serious, Doctor?
Yes, when I left the hospital, I was in the middle of a chess game with one of the interns. If he moves that bishop, I'm checkmated. Good night.
Well, better put your hat and coat away, dearie. I knew you wouldn't really go for a walk tonight.
No, you did you? You think that big fat pill pusher talked me out of it, did you? No, sir, he just got my back up. That's just what he got up. Hand me my mittens again.
Here.
Hey, wait a minute. You don't think I ought to stay till Alice's boyfriend gets here?
Oh, no. You run along, or I'll begin to suspect you of deliberately stalling.
Why, Molly, how could you think such a thing? Much less say it. Why, I've been just waiting for a night like this, with the lacy branches of the trees glittering with ice.
Oh, my.
With the clean, fresh air blowing through these mittens. I've got a hole in them, did you know it?
them when you get back, sweetheart. Have a nice walk.
Huh? Oh, I sure will. Well, so long.
Hello there. Anybody home?
Oh, well, hi, Junior. Come on in. Hey, Molly, here's Grandpa.
Cold out there.
Ah, yeah.
Say, I don't want to break up anything, Mac, if you were going out. Hello, Molly.
Hello, Mr. Wilcox. Take off your coat and sit over here by the fire.
You're not interfering with a thing, Junior. Mighty glad to see you. I was merely going out for a little walk.
Out to Dugan's Lake and back.
Dugan's Lake? Why, there are 10-foot snowdrifts between here and Dugan's Lake. They wouldn't find your body till spring. Why, it's a cold-out General Grant statue is flapping his arms.
Please, Junior, you know I don't like to hear people exaggerate. Anyway, cold weather don't frighten me. I was a fur trapper up north of Winnipeg for several years, you know that. And that's where they make the weather. I'll never forget one time. Here, let's take our coats off and be comfortable, Junior, huh?
Okay.
Yeah, that's it. I'll never forget the time I was running my trap line and I smacked into a blizzard 32 miles from my cabin.
Gee, was it cold?
Was it cold? Junior, it was so cold the teeth in my pocket comb were chattering. The smoke from my campfire froze solid before it got 5 feet in the air.
Yeah.
Just kind of congealed and fell over on the ground. And that's what saved my life.
Tell us about it, McGee, as if anybody could stop you.
Well, sir, quick's a flash. I piled peat on the campfire.
Peat? That's a kind of an inflammable turf, isn't it?
Yeah, but I was referring to Pete Umguk, an Eskimo that was working with me that season. I threw Pete on the fire because he was wearing a sheepskin coat that would make a big smoke, you see. Well, sir, fast as the smoke froze and fell down, I'd grab it and start piling it up. You ever handle any frozen smoke?
No, but we've heard a lot of hot air that was pretty solid.
Well, sir, frozen smoke is kind of like putty. Quite pleasant to work with. And in 15 minutes, I built us a little igloo out of that frozen smoke that Pete and I lived in for 10 days. And that darn near cost us our lives.
Why, pal? Did you inhale part of the ceiling?
No, but me and Pete was playing a game of Red Dog when the thaw come. All of a sudden, there we was, strangling and gasping and coughing. That frozen smoke had melted and was choking us to death. Holding my breath, I grabs Pete and hauls him out into the open air. Then I rushes back into that cloud of smoke.
Oh, dear. What on earth for, dearie?
I'd left my cigarette burning. Dangerous thing to do in the woods. Well, sir, that little experience taught me a valuable lesson, Junior.
It did, eh?
Yes, sir. From that day on, I never played another game of Red Dog with an Eskimo.
Well, if you should trap a few seals on your way to Dugan's Lake tonight, dearie, Mother could use a nice new coat, you know.
Hey, are you serious about taking a walk tonight, Mac?
I've never been seriouser in my life, Junior. There's nothing better for the inside of a man than the outside of a house, I always say. Remember, all our famous men have been great walkers.
Oh, I don't know, dearie. You know, Christopher Columbus rode a boat. Paul Revere rode a horse. And Fred Allen rides Jack Benny.
Yes, and don't forget that for a while, walking met a great deal of opposition, too.
What do you mean, opposition? Whom from?
Housewife.
Uh-oh.
Oh, how do you like that? I ran into that with my big fat eyes wide open. Why can't I ever...
Well, what I mean is, housewives used to complain about people walking over their kitchen linoleum, tracking it up with mud and snow and rain. But that was before they discovered Johnson's self-polishing glow coat.
You're not whistling Dixie, Mr. Wilcox.
Yes, you know that housewives now, they know that spilled things and foot tracks can be so easily and quickly wiped off a Johnson glow-coated linoleum. Why, now they welcome the milkman on a muddy day.
Yeah, they do if he's got any butter, anyway. Otherwise,
in fact, you know, glow-coat is one of the great labor-saving devices of the 20th century. No rubbing, no buffing. Just spread it around and let it dry. No fuss, no fume, no fret, no more popcorn.
No. Now, McGee just ate the last handful, Mr. Wilcox. Can you wait till I pop some more?
No, thank you. I've got to get along home. My wife promised me we were going to have crab bluey for dinner tonight.
Oh, well, trot along, Waxy. Don't keep him waiting.
Keep who waiting?
This crab bluey, whoever he is.
Oh, okay, pal. Good night, Molly.
Good night, Mr. Wilcox.
Oh, it's cold out there.
And now for your information, dearie. Crab Louie is a kind of a salad.
How do you know? You ever meet him?
It's not a him. It's a dish made of crab meat.
Oh, I see. Did he invent it?
Who?
This guy, Louie.
Louie who?
Well, search me. I never met him. He's a friend of Wilcox's.
Well, Doctor, we'll ask them to bring him over some night.
Sure, sure. What do we care if he's a crab? We'll jolly him up a bit. Well, I suppose I better be making some more popcorn.
No, dearie, I'll make the popcorn. You go on and take your walk. That is, if you weren't just kidding about it all this time.
What do you mean, kidding? When I say I'm going to do something, I'm going to do it. Come anything or high water. Where's my overshoes? Ah, oh, here they are.
Are you really going, McGee?
You betcha. And save a little popcorn for me. I won't be gone more than 3 or 4 hours. Nothing like a brisk hike in the winter air to give a guy an appetite. Well, so long now.
Goodbye, Pat.
Thank you, Mr. McGee. I was just about to ring the doorbell.
Oh, well, look who's here. Hi, Carsey. I'm glad to see you. Come in, come in, come in. Hey, Molly, look who's here. It's old lady, it's Mrs. Carstairs.
Do come in, Mrs. Carstairs. Shut that door, McGee, for me to side.
Carsey, you'll never know how glad I am to see you. Shake hands and pardon my mittens.
Thank you, Mr. McGee. Goodness, that fire feels good, Mrs. McGee. If I may quote my husband, I'm colder than a well digger's memories. But am I detaining you, Mr. McGee? I see you're dressed to go out.
Oh, no, nothing important, Carsey. Just going out for a little stroll.
Yes, out to Dugan's Lake and back.
Really? At 12 below zero? If you have a grudge against your insurance company, Mr. McGee, wouldn't it be simpler just to stand up in the bathtub and stick your wet finger into a light socket?
I guess you underestimate me as an outdoors man, Carsey. Did you know I was a fur trapper for several years up in the Saskatchewan country?
Oh, dear.
I'll never forget. One day I got caught in a terrific blizzard 32 miles from my cabin.
Good heavens, Mr. McGee. Was it cold?
Was it cold? My cow gave ice cream for 2 weeks.
Amazing.
Yes, it seems an utter impossibility.
Anyway, Carsey, here I was, caught in this terrific blizzard. Even the smoke from my campfire froze before it got 5 feet into the air. Just kind of congealed and fell to the ground. And that's what saved my life. Because quick's a flash, I piled peat on the fire, and when I got it going... And that little experience taught me a valuable lesson, Carsey.
Did it indeed, Mr. McGee?
Yes, sir. From that day on, I never played Red Dog with an Eskimo.
Wasn't that an interesting experience, Mrs. Carstairs?
It really was, my dear. And while it might seem incredible to some, I happen to know it's true.
You do?
Yes. You see, Mr. Carstairs and I were motoring through Maine one winter en route to our hunting lodge. Mm. My husband goes up there every year to shoot moose.
And what happened, Mrs. Carstairs?
We had a blowout just as we encountered a blizzard. But my husband leaped out of the car, lit a cigar, and started blowing smoke rings, which froze almost instantly, of course.
Oh, well, Nat.
Finally, he blew one the exact size of our tires, mounted it on the rim, and we reached our hunting lodge in the nick of time.
What did you do when it melted, Millicent?
Oh, we're still using it, my dear. Yes, it's quite amusing how that tire has baffled our ration board. And do you know, every cold winter day since that time, my husband has smoked rough-cut tobacco.
What for, Carsey?
He's trying to blow a smoke ring with a tread on it. Well, this is often very entertaining, but I simply must go. Good evening.
Good night, Mrs. Carstairs.
Good night, Millicent. Did you ever hear such a line of malarkey in all your born days? Who does she think she's kidding with that smoke ring stuff? Frozen smoke rings. Why, that's impossible.
You know how some people exaggerate, dearie.
Yeah.
And you better get out of that overcoat. It's too late to go for a walk now.
Too late for who? I ain't afraid of the dark. I said I was going to walk to Dugan's Lake and back, and by George, I'm going to do it. And right now, too. Where's my mittens? Oh, here they are. Well, so long.
Bless his brave little heart. He hates walking like a jockey and snow like the Miami Chamber of Commerce. But he'll trudge out to Dugan's Lake like a little man.
Hey, Molly, look who I found coming up our front walk. Old civic virtue himself. Come on in, Latrivia. Old man, come on in.
Quit shoving me, McGee.
Good evening, Mr. Mayor.
Good evening, Mrs. McGee. Though it certainly is a bit of cold one.
Yeah, it's cold, but it's stimulating, boy.
I don't suppose you'd have a small glass of something.
My goodness, what's the matter with me? McGee, get his honor a nice cold glass of root beer.
Why, sure, I'll...
No. Thank you, anyway. Come to think of it, if I took any liquids, I'd clink all the way home. As I was saying to our street commissioner this morning, Bunderson, I said, this is the coldest...
Incidentally, Latrivia, yes? How much does he get a year?
Who, the street commissioner?
Yeah.
Well, you're a taxpayer, so I suppose you're entitled to the information. His salary is $7,500 per annum.
How much is that a year?
Per annum means per year, McGee.
Oh. Well, is that in addition to his commissions, Latrivia?
What commissions?
Any commissions. He's a commissioner, isn't he?
Yes, but he doesn't work on commission. He gets a straight salary.
Well, then why do they call him a commissioner?
Because he belongs to the street commission, you idiot.
Oh, he belongs to the commission, but the commissions don't belong to him, huh?
Is that your idea of fair play, Latrivia? Guy works all year long earning commissions, and the city says no. You take your straight salary and like it. By George, I'm going to start an investigation, Latrivia, that'll stop...
You go right ahead, McGee. I've been investigated by bigger dunderheads than you in my day, and if I...
Now, there's no use flying into a rage, Mr. Mayor.
No.
I assure you the investigation will be fair and impartial.
Certainly. All we want is a square deal for our public servants.
Of course, but
then...
If
a man earns a commission, he's entitled to get a commission.
But he doesn't...
Plus his salary.
But he's not entitled to a commissary. To a commission. As a member of the common council. A council. What I mean to say is that the street... He's a... We all in the... That is the... McGee.
Hey?
Will you do me a favor?
Why, of course he will, Mr. Mayor.
Just name it, Latrivia.
Well, when you get to Dugan's Lake, will you walk out to the exact middle of it and jump up and down? Hard!
Now, there goes a very thoughtless guy. I don't suppose he ever stopped to think what might happen if I jumped up and down on the ice on Dugan's Lake. It's pretty thin out there in the middle. Fella could bust right through.
Oh, well, he didn't know what he was saying, most likely.
No.
Look, dearie, if you're not going to Dugan's Lake, and I wouldn't blame you if you didn't...
What do you mean if I'm not going? Certainly I'm going, and right away, too. I got my backup about this thing, by George. I'll hate myself in the morning if I don't go through with it now. So long, baby.
Wait a minute. Here's your mitten.
Huh? Oh, thanks. Well, so long.
Enjoy yourself, darling.
Okay.
Heavenly days. I do believe he's really going. Well, now, where was I? Oh, yes, page 39. The alley where the dead man had been found was a blind areaway between a building.
Hey, Molly, I'm home, safe and sound. What time is it?
Oh, hello, dearie. It's just 10:30. You've only been gone 3 hours. Did you enjoy your walk?
Oh, it was marvelous. I'm pretty tired, but it was worth it. Did you ever see the moonlight on Lake Dugan in wintertime?
Oh.
I'm telling you, it's a spectacle. The stillness. The blue shadows of the trees on the dunes.
Oh.
The swoop of a night owl over the drifted snow. Ah, by George, Molly, it's an experience that I'll never forget.
I'll get it, McGee. You must be completely worn out. Sit down and rest, sweet. 79 Wistful Vista, Molly McGee speaking. Yes? Who? Oh, he did? Oh, well, thank you very much, I'm sure. Goodbye. It was Kramer's drugstore, McGee.
Kramer's drugstore? What'd they want?
They said to tell you left your mittens on the pinball machine.
Good night.
Good night, all.
This is Harlow Wilcox, speaking for the makers of Johnson's Wax Products for Home and Industry, inviting you all to be with us again next Tuesday night. Good night. This is the National Broadcasting Company.
I'm Dennis Daly. Thanks for going along on our journey through the final 25 years of radio. radio's golden years. Join me again next time.